Saga Egmont presents Snatched by Gillian Jackson. Read by Annie Aldington. This book is dedicated to Natalia Tanchak, whose positivity and sense of humour in adversity is inspirational. Chapter 1. February the 3rd, 1988. A late-night phone call to her colleague sent a thrill of excitement shooting through Helen. After 3 weeks on the job, and barely any time out of the office, newbie social worker Helen Hanna relished being on call under the supervision of Valerie Chapman. Secretly, Helen longed for excitement, something to get her out of her allocated dusty cramped cubicle and away from the endless boring paperwork. It seemed her prayers were finally answered. The call, which was to initiate her to the seedier side of life, was from a concerned neighbour. A possible child left at home alone, Valerie explained, grabbing her coat and heading for the door, a deep frown on her face. The police will meet us at the scene. Helen scurried after her and shivered as the biting wind gusted around them. By 11:30 p.m., the two women arrived at the address they'd been given, to be greeted by an irate neighbour who threw out accusations like confetti. The council housing estate was one Valerie was all too familiar with. Many of her clients lived there. The house in question was in complete darkness, but the neighbour insisted children were inside.
That cow doesn't deserve to have kids. She leaves them to fend for themselves while she's off with her latest fella.
Valerie was already peering through the letterbox, calling out to anyone who might be inside. For a few moments, there was silence, broken only by the insistent neighbour instructing them as to what they should be doing. Her raucous voice and colourful language did nothing to ease the situation, and if children were inside, they'd probably be more afraid of this woman than of being alone. Then, finally, a faint noise, a sob from within, confirmed the presence of at least one child. Valerie spoke softly through the letterbox, while flapping her arm behind her to keep the neighbour away.
"Hello, sweetheart. My name's Valerie. Are you okay in there?"
Silence. Then another muffled sob.
"Can you come to the door and tell me your name?"
The police arrived during this rather one-sided conversation. Valerie stood and turned towards the two men who exited the car. "I'm pretty certain there's a child inside, and most probably alone." The officers made an immediate decision to forcibly enter the property. Valerie spoke through the letterbox once more to warn the child of what would happen.
"There are two policemen with me, and they're going to open the door so we can come in. Okay? Can you hear me, sweetheart? It might be noisy, so stand well back, and we'll be with you in a minute."
A minute was all it took to force the flimsy lock, allowing the police to enter the house. Valerie and Helen were close behind, aware that the police needed to perform an on-the-spot risk assessment, but anxious for the child, who must be frightened by their presence. The first officer flicked a light switch in the lobby, but nothing happened.
"No money in the meter, I should think."
He produced a torch from his jacket, while his colleague went back to the car to switch on the headlights and turn the vehicle around to face the house. A tiny lobby housed a staircase, a door to the right, presumably the living room, and a door facing, which probably led to a kitchen. As Helen's eyes took in the layout of the rooms, her nostrils were filled with a sickening smell, which nearly caused her to retch. Valerie glanced over her shoulder and smiled wryly at the younger girl.
"You'll get used to it. Dirty nappies."
The police officer opened the first door, where the sparsely furnished small square room was flooded with light from the car headlights. Two small children huddled in a corner, like frightened animals, blinking against the blinding light. The officer swept the room with his eyes before giving Valerie the okay to approach the children. A girl of no more than 4 or 5 shielded a younger boy, both of them squeezing their thin little bodies as far as they could into the corner, as if the walls could offer them protection. Helen gasped at the sight, but a look from her colleague warned her to keep her emotions in check. Valerie slowly squatted in front of the children, not too close.
"Hello, I'm Valerie, and this is my friend Helen. What's your name?"
The little girl eyed her suspiciously, then whispered,
"Joanne."
The boy was silent, but Valerie continued smiling and asked where their mother was. No answer. The little boy started to cry. His sister gripped him even tighter, her wide blue eyes full of suspicion and fear. Helen briefly appraised the room they were in. Even in the patchy light shed by the car, the space looked filthy. The walls were damp with old peeling paper and mildew, forming grotesque-looking patterns across the ceiling. There was no carpet, just old and uneven bare floorboards. An ancient brown sofa stood against one wall, stuffing hanging out of the arms, and seat cushions so threadbare there was more foam showing through than fabric. A side panel of glass was broken in the bay window and held together with brown parcel tape, utterly useless for keeping out the cold February night. A television stood in one corner on an upturned box, its wide screen and shiny black newness incongruous with its surroundings. Valerie continued to speak calmly to the children, attempting to gain their trust. Then turning to Helen, she whispered,
"Go and fetch the blankets from the boot of my car."
Helen hurried off, grateful to be out in the fresh air, but simultaneously feeling guilty about her revulsion for the situation inside. The first policeman stood by his car on his radio, reporting into the station, while his colleague searched upstairs. Helen retrieved the blankets and took them back into the house as the second policeman came downstairs.
"No sign of anyone else. Who knows how long those kids have been alone? The fridge is all but empty. Poor little sods."
He nodded to Helen.
"You taking them now?"
Yes, we are." Helen was floundering. Having longed for something to happen, this situation had thrown her. The smell was making her feel sick, and she longed for a hot shower and her bed, although it was doubtful whether the images she'd seen could be erased sufficiently to allow a peaceful night's sleep. Taking the blankets to Valerie, she found her colleague trying to persuade the little girl to move away from her brother. Valerie took a blanket and draped it around Joanne's shoulders, but the child still clung to her brother. It looked as if they'd have to lift them out as one. As Helen leaned over to help, the girl bit into her arm and scratched at her face. Valerie managed to wrap the girl's flailing arms in the blanket, but was rewarded by a piercing feral scream, making the boy cry even louder. The senior social worker held the girl tightly and motioned her colleague to do the same with her brother. Helen was so stunned that it took a few seconds to respond. The boy wriggled in her arms, screaming, almost deafening her. He wore only a thin vest, and his legs were covered with excrement, the smell of which was overpowering. Valerie managed to lift the girl into the back of her car and asked Helen to get in with the boy. The pair clung together, their limbs a tangle of bones with barely any flesh on them. Thankfully, they lapsed into silence as they were driven away. The children needed an examination by a doctor, and taking them to A&E was the quickest way to do so at that time of night. As they carried them into the hospital, Helen found that swaddling the boy in the blanket and holding him close calmed him. Valerie did the same with the girl. Neither child spoke to the social workers or the nurses, but seemed content to be held, both still. By 1 a.m, a doctor had examined the children, declaring them dehydrated and malnourished. Valerie accompanied a nurse to bathe the brother and sister while Helen was sent in search of coffee. The night's events had shocked her. It would take more than coffee to erase the images of those neglected children from her mind. Later, while the children slept, Valerie sat with Helen and talked over their evening. It's not the worst case I've come across, but we don't know all the details yet. It looks as if they've been alone for a few days, and the police will already be trying to trace the mother, or father, if there's one on the scene. They'll be kept in hospital for a few days. They've had drinks and a little food. But I've never come across such malnutrition before. There's head lice to deal with too. The nursing staff will have their hands full tomorrow. You need to check your hair when you go home, which I suggest you do now. It's been a difficult night, but it's even harder on those poor kids. Keep that in mind. Valerie smiled. Helen knew she'd never forget this case. The sight of those terrified children would stay with her forever. Walking away with tears in her eyes, Helen Hannah wondered what the future held for Joanne and her brother. Chapter 2. Day 1. April 2017. Even after two full terms at his new school, Danny loved it. The atmosphere and huge modern building still thrilled him, as did the full timetable crammed with subjects new to him, such as languages, chemistry and physics. That particular morning, they'd had a French lesson with Mr. Armand, a real Frenchman who made his lessons fun. He told them his name was of German origin and meant bold or hardy, and the whole class laughed when he struck a pose like a strong man. Danny thought he might like to take German as well as French. His dad always said that languages can get you places. Danny declared St. Bede's to be awesome, with at least five times the number of pupils than the junior school he'd attended. He was finally growing up, and even his parents treated him differently. He owned his first mobile phone and was allowed to walk to and from school alone, a journey of almost half an hour, a pain in bad weather, yet exciting. Danny was also the proud owner of a door key, so he could let himself in to wait until his mother finished work, instead of going to the homework club. It was only for an hour or so, and Danny was pleased his parents trusted him to be in the house alone. As he made his way home on Monday afternoon, Danny's head was bowed against the driving rain, the hood of his parka limiting his vision, with nothing visible except the pavement in front of him. He heard a vehicle pull up nearby, but thought nothing of it until he was grabbed from behind. Wriggling and kicking, Danny did his best to break free, but whoever held him was strong. As he was lifted into the van, the door slammed shut behind him, and a hood of some kind was roughly pulled over his head. He could see nothing. Danny's heart sounded like a drum throbbing in his ears. He shouted to be released, but the effort only earned him a slap on the side of his head, and a man's voice growled at him to shut up. Then he was roughly tied with his hands by his side, so he couldn't move his arms or pull the hood off his head. Danny began crying. He couldn't help it. Then, feeling a warm wetness trickle down his legs, he realised he'd peed himself. Shaking and sobbing, utter helplessness overwhelmed him, and he was ashamed for letting the man grab him without putting up more of a fight. The van seemed to drive for ages, although it was probably little more than an hour. The road became bumpy, and Danny was tossed about in the back of the van, curled up, wet, cold and whimpering. With his arms bound by his side, there was no way to stop himself from rolling about on the dirty van floor, occasionally bumping into the man and receiving a shove when he did. The smell of oil and burnt rubber made him feel quite nauseous, but he knew it would only add to his discomfort if he was sick. Danny had never before been so afraid, and he longed for his parents and the warm comfort of their home. Eventually, the engine stopped, and the sound of the driver getting out of the cab and coming to the back doors brought another rush of fear to Danny's mind. With his breath coming in shallow gulps, he squeezed into the corner of the van, trying to make himself as small as possible, in the futile hope that whoever they were, they might go away and forget about him. They didn't. The man who was in the back with him dragged Danny towards the doors before hoisting him over his shoulders as if he was no weight at all. Kicking his legs around was useless and earned another, even harder slap to his head. For a moment, Danny felt sick and dizzy. Then he allowed his body to go limp. It seemed pointless to struggle with this large, strong man. Unable to see his surroundings was frustrating and terrifying, but Danny concentrated on listening for sounds that might give him a clue as to where they were. It was quiet, with only the faint sound of vehicles in the distance and the happy song of birds busily flying from tree to tree without a care in the world. The rain was still falling, and the men's boots squelched as they walked, as if they were stepping in mud. It could have been a farm, or perhaps a cottage in the country somewhere. Danny was carried inside and up a flight of stairs, then dropped onto the hard floor, sending a sharp pain through his hip and down his right leg. As the man left the room, closing the door firmly behind him, Danny heard the sound of bolts sliding into place. Two bolts locking him in, then the sound of the man stomping down the stairs. For a minute, Danny remained still, listening. There was the sound of voices downstairs, the same two men, but it wasn't possible to make out what they were saying. When he was as sure as he could be that he was alone in the room, Danny freed his arms from their loose binding and pulled off the hood to look around. He was in a square room with a small window, bare floorboards, and nothing other than a dirty-looking mattress in one corner and a bucket in another. A couple of blankets were on the end of the mattress. The walls were half covered with peeling paper, and the damp was running down to the rotting skirting boards. It was so very different to his bedroom at home, a place he briefly wondered if he'd ever see again. Danny remembered his rucksack with his mobile phone, but realised he must have dropped it when the man grabbed him. Perhaps someone would find it and know he'd been kidnapped. Taking off his coat and then his wet trousers, Danny used one of the blankets to rub his legs dry, as the shame that he'd been unable to control himself brought a flush to his face. He hung the trousers on the door handle to dry. But it was so cold in the room, and he was shivering, his teeth chattering together. Danny put his coat back on, and sitting on the mattress, wrapped his legs in the other blanket. The tears came again, and curling up on his side, he sobbed bitterly. Chapter 3 Day 1 Eventually, Danny's tears dried. He rubbed at his eyes, blew his nose, and thought seriously about his situation. Clearly, he'd been kidnapped, and it was up to him, his duty, to do his best to escape. Danny stood, wrapped the blanket around his legs, and shuffled over to the window. The dirty glass was cracked, the frame warped, and someone had nailed the window frame to the base so it wouldn't open. A heavy mesh encased the outside, making it difficult, though not impossible, to see through. The mesh was presumably to deter him from climbing out of the window. Danny screwed up his eyes and peered into the distance. A main road was visible, separated from the house by a couple of fields. To the left was woodland, not particularly dense, but with a path leading into the trees, which could mean that someone walked through it, hopefully with regularity. The noise of the traffic couldn't be heard from inside. Adjacent to the house was a large barn, or what was left of one, with more holes than roof from what Danny could see, and only half a door swinging precariously on a large rusty hinge. A white van was parked near the house, too close to see little more than the roof, and certainly not the number plate, but he reckoned it was a Ford Transit. Danny sighed and went to sit back down on the dirty mattress to think. He expected his mother would be home and wondering where he was by then. What would she do first? Probably ring Ethan to see if he was with him. Ethan lived a couple of blocks away from their house, and the two boys had been friends since their first day at primary school. Danny was glad when they both enrolled at St. Bede's, although they were in different classes. Both boys made other friends, yet still saw each other often, particularly during school holidays. If only Danny had waited to walk home with Ethan, this might not have happened. When Danny's mother learned he wasn't at Ethan's, what would she do? She wasn't one to panic, but he knew she'd worry when he wasn't home. He still had his watch on. It was 5:30 p.m. He wondered if she'd called the police yet. The front door banged, and Danny jumped up and ran to the window. It looked like both men were leaving. He could only just make them out through the murky glass, but there was the sound of two car doors slamming. Danny had been right. The van was a Ford Transit, and he watched it drive down the uneven lane they'd taken to get there, turn left, and disappear out of sight. Presumably, Danny was alone, unless there'd been someone else in the house waiting for them to arrive. Dare he risk shouting? The desire to get out of that stark, filthy room was greater than his fear of a third person being around, so he shouted as loudly as he could, banging on the door until his fists were sore. There was no response, which probably meant he was alone. Danny scanned the room again, searching for a possible way of escape. The door was old but solid, and he knew there were bolts on the outside. The window wouldn't open. He'd seen the nails, and if he smashed the glass, he would still have the problem of the mesh outside, which looked rather heavy-duty and was probably nailed down like the window frame. With such a bare room and both ways of exit ruled out, Danny felt the tears sting his eyes once more. He sniffed, wiping his nose on his parka sleeve, and swallowed hard to stop himself crying. A bare light bulb hung from the ceiling, and when he flipped the switch, it was a relief to find it worked. It was bad enough being there, but the dark would only add to his misery. By 7:30 p.m, it was completely dark outside, and Danny had been alone for over 2 hours. Finally, after failing to come up with an escape plan, he sat on the mattress and watched a spider spinning a web in the corner of the window. Danny needed to use the bucket as a toilet, assuming that was why it was there, and he was feeling hungry and cold. Suddenly, headlights danced across the wall, and the sound of an engine in the drive told him his captors were returning. Should he be relieved? No, he was terrified, his heart pounding wildly. Being alone was so much better than having those men in the house. Would they hurt him? Danny sniffed back the tears and listened as the van doors opened, then slammed closed. He found he was holding his breath, listening. But the voices were just noise, the words indistinguishable. Danny thought one of the voices sounded like a woman. He heard them enter the house and wondered if they'd come upstairs to check on him, afraid they would, but somehow needing to know more about his captors, to be able to look at their faces and assess what his fate might be. Danny anxiously listened for over an hour, but no one came. There were sounds of a television and movement in the room directly below, but nothing more. Eventually, the van started up again. Two doors slammed, and it drove away from the house. The television still blared downstairs, so probably someone had stayed behind. Within minutes, footsteps pounded on the stairs, the bolts were released, and the door creaked. Danny braced himself for seeing one of the men, afraid yet determined not to show it. He stood with his fists balled and his jaw tight, but relaxed when he saw who was standing in the open doorway. A skinny boy of about his age. The boy looked at him and grinned.
"So you're the fat rich kid then?"
He showed a mouthful of chipped and crooked teeth and wore old dirty jeans and a jumper at least two sizes too small for him, which was unravelling at the sleeves. Having expected to see one of his captors, this boy was a shock, and it wasn't until he'd stepped inside and closed the door that Danny realised he'd missed an opportunity to attempt an escape. As if the boy had read his mind, he stared at Danny.
"Don't even think about making a run for it. They've got guns."
Was he telling the truth? Danny wasn't sure. He thought only gangs in London carried guns. The boy peered at the bucket in the corner, which Danny had reluctantly used earlier.
"Gaw, it bloody stinks in here," There isn't a bathroom.
Danny's voice was croaky and weak.
There is, but you're not to be let out the room.
The boy lifted his chin, as if he was the one making the rules.
Who are you? Why am I here? Just call me Lewis. Is that your first name or last? Doesn't matter. Lewis will do.
Danny wanted to ask more, but was unsure about this boy. They eyed each other up. Then Danny repeated,
Why am I here? What do you think, idiot? You've been kidnapped, and your rich parents are going to have to pay up if they want to get you back. But they're not particularly rich. Why choose us? Because they're rich. You go to that posh school, don't you? And live in a big house and all.
Danny didn't know how to answer. Being rich was relative, he supposed.
So, are you with the kidnappers, then?
The question made Lewis laugh.
Yeah, suppose I am. Me and my mum are going to watch you. For a cut of the money, of course. If you don't try to escape, it'll be much easier. And we might even let you use the bathroom.
Lewis nodded towards the bucket and wrinkled his nose.
You might get some food, too.
Danny was hungry. He'd only had a sandwich at lunchtime, but he also felt sick, probably from fear. Suddenly, an angry voice called from downstairs. Lewis turned sharply and quickly left the room, sliding the two bolts into place before going down. Danny saw no one else all evening. Although aware of voices and movement downstairs, the door to his bedroom remained firmly closed. Lewis brought no food or drink, as he'd hinted, and Danny's stomach ached with hunger. Thinking over his predicament, he decided that not knowing who his captors were or seeing their faces was far worse than if he'd seen them. Finally, Danny fell asleep, wrapped up as best as he could in his clothes and the two dirty blankets, which smelled of mould. Danny's sleep was fitful, filled with fearful dreams, as he tossed and turned in the shadowy darkness of his prison. Chapter 4 Day 2 Martha leaned on the kitchen table, her elbows on the wooden surface, and her head resting despondently in her hands. The house was quiet, with the only noise coming from the bathroom above, where her husband Richard was taking a shower. Neither had slept the previous night. Danny was missing, their son. Their only child was out there somewhere, afraid, possibly alone, maybe hurt. During the endless hours of night, Martha tortured herself with every possible scenario playing on a loop through her mind, over and over again. But outside, the blanket of darkness was lifting, and the wet streets would soon be filled with early morning commuters. For once, she would not be one of them.
Please, God, let this not be happening. Let me wake up and find my world is back on its axis.
The indignity of the previous evening still burned in her mind, even though Martha understood that the police must follow precise procedures. Within half an hour of reporting their son missing, the house swarmed with police officers who searched every inch of their home. It was a large house for three people, and the police were thorough, checking every cupboard, wardrobe, and any space big enough to hold a child, or, Martha thought, the body of a child. Inside her head, Martha was screaming at this waste of valuable time, and she could see the tension in Richard's face, clearly offended that the police could suspect them of harming their child, yet they were both sadly aware that it does happen. They held their silence, knowing the search must be completed before the police could begin the task of looking elsewhere for Danny. Martha couldn't bear to watch as strangers' hands explored every space in her home, even beneath the beds. She was consumed with the desire to follow the police officers around and clean every door and cupboard they touched, but of course she didn't. The whole process left her with the uncomfortable feeling of having been violated. They may as well have searched her body too. Every square foot of the garden was explored, the garage, the shed, and the greenhouse, and as Martha watched from the window, she saw uniformed officers poking around with sticks, looking in the flower beds for newly turned earth. An eager police dog sniffed everywhere, its tail wagging as it worked with its handler. Her heart pounded as she longed for them to finish searching their home and move on to find her son. More embarrassment was to follow when the police asked Richard and Martha where they'd been from 4 p.m. until they reported their son missing nearly 2 hours later, and they admitted they'd been at their respective places of work. Danny had made his own way home. A young PC raised a judgmental eyebrow, but nothing was said. Martha had tried ringing Danny's mobile dozens of times, but it went to voicemail on every occasion. This in itself was troubling. Danny always answered when his phone was switched on, which he did on leaving school. If nothing else, Martha Stone was pragmatic. The owner of a successful recruitment agency, she was a busy working mother who filled every minute of the day productively. Martha was 43, with ash blonde hair, usually tied neatly with a clasp at the base of her neck, and grey-green eyes, the same colouring as her son. She was 5'6" tall and of slim build, more to do with genetics than any regular exercise. Martha had no time for such luxuries. Richard, too, worked more hours than was healthy as a barrister, and their 11-year-old son, Danny, had his own schedule to which he dutifully adhered. The Stones loved their only child, but had never the time nor the inclination to baby him. The small family were content in their world, with the cogs of everyday life slotting neatly into place. The family moved to their present address in Bristol 4 years previously in anticipation of getting Danny a place at St. Bede's, a popular private school that consistently produced excellent academic results. Their son was a sensible boy, and despite only being 11, he was allowed an increasing amount of freedom, especially since leaving primary school. He walked to and from school alone, and his parents never feared for his safety, as they resided in a respectable leafy area on the outskirts of the city. Surely a boy could walk safely to and from school in such a place. Martha had thought the saying, "wrapping your child in cotton wool," to be a silly phrase, but that was before Danny went missing. Now, if she could only have him back, she'd take so much better care of him and cherish him as he deserved. All night long, Martha constantly questioned herself. Am I a bad mother? Do I somehow deserve this nightmare? Could this be punishment for what I've done in the past? Is this the price I have to pay? But the answers were irrelevant in the circumstances, and Martha knew that whatever the outcome of their present ordeal, she would always berate herself for her failings as a parent. Logic told her she was not to blame. She was only human, flesh and blood, like everyone else. But she couldn't help wondering if she'd somehow brought this on herself. The questions haunted Martha, with not a single positive answer to soothe the rising panic within her. Perhaps it wasn't the time for such soul-searching, yet her mind was in overdrive. Danny was missing, and she had no idea what to do. 6 a.m. marked 14 hours since Danny was last seen. 14 hours during which Martha had neither slept nor eaten. 14 hours during which she'd cried bitterly, shouted at her husband and the police, and against all advice and common sense, run out into the night in a futile search of the streets. It was clear that none of those actions had helped even in the slightest measure. Instead, they'd only served to exhaust her and bring unnecessary concern to those who were trying to help. Footsteps sounded on the stairs, and Richard entered the kitchen. Martha lifted her head, noticing how terrible he looked. His brown eyes, which usually lit up his face, were sunken into his head, and the dark circles beneath them made him appear ill. His short sandy hair was sticking up in spikes where he'd toweled it dry and run his fingers through it in exasperation. Richard appeared to have aged 10 years in as many hours. They sat together in silence, exhausted, impotent, and scared. Totally, utterly scared. Chapter 5. Day 2. It was the early hours of the morning before the police had finally left the Stones' house. They asked question after question, while directing the search for Danny from their living room. Martha desperately craved even the slightest grain of hope to grasp hold of, and consequently asked questions the police couldn't possibly answer. If only there were a set format for such cases, stage 1, 2, and 3. But there isn't. There are no rules and regulations for those involved in a child's disappearance to abide by. The police were still unsure if Danny's disappearance was a kidnap, an abduction, for reasons his parents couldn't bear to think about, or a case of a child running away, or simply being lost. The latter two, Martha thought, were unlikely. She knew their son, and he wouldn't go wandering off alone. If he were lost anywhere, which also seemed highly unlikely, Danny would use his mobile phone, or at least have the sense to seek help from an appropriate source. Martha and Richard were quizzed relentlessly about their relationship with Danny and his current state of mind. The detective inspector, Alex Radford, who introduced himself as the senior investigating officer, tried to reassure them that most cases of a missing child turned out to be an attempt to run away. So they listened to his questions about family arguments, recent disagreements, and any excessive discipline against which Danny might be rebelling. But they could think of nothing that would make him consider such an action, leaving only two possibilities: kidnap or abduction. So far, there'd been no demand for a ransom, which made a targeted kidnapping seem unlikely. The thought of this being a random abduction frightened Martha. She didn't need to ask why children were abducted. She read the papers and watched the television news. Thoughts of child trafficking, sexual abuse, and all kinds of violence spun unchecked through Martha's mind, and, she presumed, through Richard's too. He was a barrister, and all too aware of some of the most appalling crimes imaginable. Trying to push such horrors out of her head and concentrate on something constructive was futile. Where was Danny? Had he slept at all? It was impossible to imagine he would be anything other than afraid. Martha could think of no scenario which would be anything other than traumatic for their son. Even if he was found now, unharmed, it was possible that some psychological damage would already have been suffered. Danny was an 11-year-old boy, intelligent and sensible, yes, but not in the least equipped to handle this cruel and possibly violent separation from his family. Whatever horrors he was experiencing would almost certainly cause irrevocable damage. When they got him back, Martha thought, she would most certainly wrap him up in cotton wool and never let him out of her sight again. The sound of the letterbox startled Martha, but it was only the paperboy on his rounds, unaware of the nightmare being lived out behind the front door he visited each day. Richard went into the hall to pick up their paper, and then moved to look out of the window at the sound of a car stopping. He dropped the newspaper on the kitchen table without a glance. Martha rose to join him, and he slipped a comforting arm around her shoulders. Two cars pulled up, with five officers stepping out to make their way to the Stones' front door. The gruesome circus was beginning again. A huge sob rose in Martha's chest, and she covered her mouth with her hand to prevent it from escaping. Suni Haywood, a young constable, was the first to enter the house. She looked no more than a child, fresh-faced and eager to help. Martha wondered if this was her first case. Suni was designated as the family liaison officer, Flo, and would spend most of her time with the Stones. After saying hello, good morning seemed inappropriate, Suni went to the kitchen to make coffee, a task she'd repeated almost hourly the previous evening. She carried a large carton of milk with her, a thoughtful gesture, as Martha couldn't concentrate on anything practical. Following Suni were D.I. Alex Radford, the lead officer, D.S. Graham Foster, and two unfamiliar faces. The latter two were introduced, but Martha almost immediately forgot their names. It was evident from the expressions of all the visitors that there was no news, good or bad. Martha thought D.I. Radford looked rather crumpled. A tall man, perhaps the same age as Richard, or a little older, he had a long face with dark, deep-set eyes and an unreadable expression. His first question of the day was to ask if anyone had approached them concerning a ransom.
But you've put a trace on the phones. You know they haven't.
Martha wasn't thinking straight.
Yes, but there's a slim possibility you may have been contacted personally or by letter, Radford added.
Of course. Sorry.
Martha felt foolish. Richard informed the DI they'd heard nothing, even though neither of them had slept at all.
It's only 6:30, so there's still a fair chance we might hear something today.
They were assembled in the lounge by then, where Radford sat and opened a rather battered old briefcase. Removing a handful of leaflets, he passed one to Richard for him to see. Danny's face smiled up from the paper at his father. It was their most recent photograph, taken on a rare visit to his grandparents' home. Bold type posed the question, "Have you seen this child?" And police contact numbers were printed underneath.
"These have been circulated to all forces throughout the country and posted widely in the locality. Our officers will shortly resume house-to-house inquiries, showing this picture, and the community officer will be at Danny's school this morning to address their assembly and interview his classmates."
Soon he appeared with a tray of steaming mugs, which they all accepted, whether they wanted drinks or not. She carried the morning paper under her arm and placed it on the coffee table.
"Will the press know about this?" Martha asked, unsure if it would be a good thing or not.
"It's bound to get out. These flyers and the house-to-house will ensure as much. What I'd like to do is hold a press conference, so we can retain some control over what the press print. And hopefully the publicity will help us find Danny," Radford explained.
He picked up the newspaper, and a white envelope dropped onto the table. Everyone's eyes focused on it, but no one made a move to pick it up.
"Has this come this morning?" Radford asked, waving the paper in the air. "Yes, the paper boy delivered it just before you arrived," Richard told him.
Pulling a pair of latex gloves from his pocket, Alex Radford carefully lifted the envelope, pulled open the flap, and slid out the letter inside. Everyone in the room was aware of what it must be. Would it be put together with words cut from magazines, Martha wondered, or was that just in old films? Her heart pounded rapidly. She felt sure the others in the room would be able to hear it. The detective seemed to take an age to read the letter, and his face gave nothing away. Radford then looked grave.
"They want £300,000.
Chapter 6. Day 2. Martha watched as Richard made to grab the letter, but Radford pulled it away, dropping it into an evidence bag that Graham Foster was holding open.
"Sorry, sir, but we need to preserve it for forensics."
Radford then spoke to the two new officers, instructing them to find the paperboy and discover how he came to deliver the letter. They left immediately.
"Isn't this good news? At least we know that Dan is still alive," Richard asked.
Martha gasped at his words.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.